Her Vine, Christine Keeler's story exposes the absurdity of Westminster sex hysteria. Christine Keeler, who has died aged 75, was one of the most iconic faces of the 20th century. In her prime, she was up there with the likes of Marilyn Monroe, possessed of that same kind of disturbing sexuality, half child, half woman, the kind that can drive ordinarily sane men out of their senses. It was this seemingly irresistible allure that brought Keeler, and the subsequent sex scandal that almost destroyed the government of the day, to the attention of the authorities. Two of her lovers got involved in a bitter feud that ended in gunfire. It also caused her untold damage at a very young age. In her autobiography, she wrote about her stepfather who molested her at the age of 12, urging her to run away with him. She also attracted the attentions of the men whose children she babysat, and had her first illegal abortion aged 17. Her real father abandoned Keeler's mother when Christine was very young, and it is clear her willingness to be seduced was more to do with an eternal search for a loving father figure than any sort of 60s enthusiasm for free love. The Keelers of that world were not the ones to find liberation in the new sexual freedoms of that era. Those privileges belonged to women of a more ideological class, imbued with the confidence of status and money. For working-class girls like Christine, the spirit of the age took away the few protections afforded them by marriage, since the men who exploited them no longer even had to do the courtesy of making honest women of them. Thus Stephen Ward, the society osteopath who discovered her as a teenager dancing in a bar in Soho, found a girl already bruised by life and willing to act as his sexual pass to powerful men looking for a good time girl with no strings attached. And Keeler, already sexually desensitized and in modern parlance groomed to perfection, went along with it. What else could she have done? She was passed around from man to man like a broken doll, damaged but still beautiful enough to play with. Had she been born in a different time or place, she would have emerged the victim in the subsequent scandal. Instead, while the men in her story, disgraced minister John Perfumo and Ward, have, to a certain extent, been rehabilitated by history, Keeler, as she herself put it rather sadly not long ago, remained characterized as that bloody whore. But Keeler's story is not just one of a beautiful girl who became a pawn for powerful men. It also lends proportion to so much of the modern morals and attitudes that surround Westminster today, and shines a light on the absurdity of some of them. How different Keeler's experiences, her bottom red from being pinched, her virtue shamed in public, raped by one of her suitors, were from those who currently claim abuse at Westminster, where a mere invitation to dinner is met with hysteria and a Me Too hashtag, and where remarking favorably on someone's appearance risks bringing down a career. Consider her exploitation in the context of the minor infractions that these days seem to constitute sexual assault, and it almost feels like an insult to her memory. As women, we have thankfully come a long way since Keeler's day. But so much of the hysteria that now surrounds the debate around sexuality in public life risks detracting from the real abuse that still exists in society and the modern-day Christine Keelers who are still suffering at the hands of wicked men. Keeler was not the first great beauty to have wielded so much power over influential men, yet enjoyed none for herself. Let's hope she has finally found some peace. Poor Pippa Middleton. I'm sure her visit to Bristol Royal Hospital yesterday on behalf of the British Red Cross had been in the diary for months, but there was something about her appearance, the chic navy polo neck, the stylish skirt, the understated makeup and perfect chestnut locks, that made it seem like she was trying just that little bit too hard to outshine Meghan Markle. Any such suggestion would, of course, be highly improper. Still, I seem to remember Labour lecturing us not so long ago about NHS nurses being forced to use food banks as a result of evil Tory cuts. But now we hear that a quarter of nurses are obese. Someone is obviously telling, as well as scoffing, a load of porky pies. No surprise Jeremy Corbyn insisted on a Marks and Spencer suit to appear on the cover of GQ. M&S is the go-to brand for politicians wishing to occupy the all-important middle ground. David Cameron used it to poshify himself, Corbyn is using it to, well, de Corbyn himself. Moral of the story? By all means trust the brand, but don't necessarily trust the person wearing it. Sir Martin Morbick, the senior High Court judge who is charged with conducting the inquiry into the Grenfell Tower fire, has come in for some criticism on account of his double-barreled name. Some worry that he lacks a real understanding of the issues facing those affected, and have launched a petition, backed by none other than £45,000 a day people's songstress, Adele, to force the government to appoint additional panel members. This is very unfair on Sir Martin. After all, just because the man's surname reminds residents of their new double-barreled MP, Labour's Emma Dentcode, who in recent weeks has revealed herself to be variously racist, bigoted, sexist and generally downright ghastly, does not mean that he should be tarred with the same brush. The number of schoolchildren with a part-time job has fallen by a fifth in the past 5 years, a sign, apparently, of the inherent laziness of this generation. But that's just not the case. My daughter is desperate to get a Saturday job, but no one will take her on because she's not yet 16 and therefore falls foul of all sorts of EU employment legislation designed to protect against exploitation, but which actually ends up stifling initiative. Having orchestrated online bullying campaigns against stationery chain Paper Chase and Pizza Hut for entering into commercial partnerships with the Daily Mail and the Sun, self-appointed arbiters of free speech stop funding hate have turned their attention on that well-known bastion of evil, the NSPCC. Its crime? Daring to launch an appeal with readers of the Sunday Express. It's funny, isn't it, the lengths that this organization will go to prevent companies, and now charities, taking part in joint ventures with newspapers whose editorial line they disapprove of. And yet when it comes to the misuse of British taxpayers' money, with millions being funneled into the pockets of tyrants and jihadists via misdirected foreign aid, a scandal that was exposed by this very newspaper, their silence is deafening. After all, why should they bother tackling genuine hate-mongers when it is so much easier to seek to undermine the free press, without which such grave abuses of power would never be exposed? A big problem in the fight against plastic waste are milk and juice cartons, which can't be easily recycled. Why not set up a scheme where such essentials are delivered to doorsteps in reusable glass bottles? We could call it the milkman.